Hey guys, welcome back to another episode of the Ask a Muso podcast, brought to you by Jim's Cleaning, Butterham South. I am taking you across the world today and very excited to have my first international guest on for the series. I'll let him introduce himself.
Hey, how's it going? My name is Elijah Martinez. I'm from the United States, born and raised in California, and I know many people have heard of that. But I actually recently moved, and I've been living in Texas for the past few months, where a lot of my family is. So I now reside in Texas. I consider myself a Texan, I guess, but very happy to be here.
What is Texas like at the moment? So what are the differences you've noticed? Like, I know you've been playing a fair bit in and around and jumping on airplanes, which is crazy to an Australian, but you've been doing a bit of stuff like that. What's the music scene like in Texas? What are you able to do?
Yeah, well, I live in Dallas. So it's they call it a metroplex. There's Dallas and then Dallas-Fort Worth even, or DFW. That all just basically means there's two big cities and then a bunch of small like suburb cities all around. It's a huge area, and honestly, there's a lot here. And as far as the way the country's been, and you know, but with COVID and whatever over the past year plus, Texas itself has been able to open up a lot quicker than what I'm used to back home. So there's already shows. I mean, there's a show tonight. Like my coworkers were already talking about, oh, are you going to the Fall of Troy show? I mean, they're literally in town. Like a bunch of cool things happen all the time now. And it's just such a large area. I mean, there's basically everything. Before I moved out here, I had already had family out here for the past 6-7 years. And then I've played out here on tour, I mean, over half a dozen times just alone, just in bands I've been in. So I have a pretty good idea of what the scene's like, but being that things are just opening up more and more and more, I'm seeing it more differently than I did before. But in general, there's so much, and it's amazing. I live here. I work in music pretty much full time. I work for Guitar Center, and I've been off and on with them for closer to a decade. Back in the day, I was in sales, started a different career, then rehired when I was able to do it part time as an instructor. So I've been teaching drums for a long time. And so in being like in it again and full time is pretty awesome. So I work literally with brand new musicians, seasoned musicians. My store actually gets celebrities once in a while, just being in the area that we're in. So it's the weirdest thing, and I've missed all of them. So
That's good, perfect timing.
I'm always off the day it happens, so I see my coworkers posting on Facebook like, oh, you know, Mudvayne came in, or you know, whoever, you know, Bruce Springsteen's guitarist or whatever. And I'm just like, okay, cool. Like, I guess I'll just, you know, show
I'm gonna
up.
Stop
and,
taking off yeah, Tuesdays. Yeah, never going to take off another Tuesday.
Exactly. Or it's a good thing for when I'm off, everyone knows someone's going to come in. So.
Yeah, well, yeah, exactly. That's exciting. Well, I suppose with your on and off relationship with that, like, I suppose music has been a massive part as in a job sense for, you know, you say best part of a decade.
Yeah.
How long has music been a part of your life as a player? Was drums the only instrument? How'd you get into that? Where'd that all start?
I started around the age of 7-ish, being interested in piano. And that was because my sister, closest to me in age, was already playing, and she was getting really proficient quickly. And I'm the youngest, so she's only a couple years older than me. And I was kind of impressed and intrigued and decided to give it a shot. And I walked out of my first recital too scared to play. But I was just like, okay, like, I don't know. So you'll see a pattern here. But after that, if you fast forward a couple of years around the 4th or 5th grade, which I don't know how old that is. I mean, maybe 10, somewhere around there, I'm guessing. I decided guitar sounds cool, you know, and I was getting into different music, and I just thought, you know, I wanted to play some rock and roll, like play some guitar. So like any other kid, got my parents to sign me up for that. They bought me an acoustic, which they didn't know much about it. So now that I know a lot about everything, it's funny because they bought me a classical guitar, but I wanted to play, you know, more modern music. So I had a classical guitar and then took lessons for maybe 6 months, if that, which is a little bit longer than I took lessons for piano. So there's some progress.
Gradually getting better.
Exactly. But then eventually I was just like, not that I wasn't feeling it, but it didn't click yet. So I was like, okay. And then I even tried switching over to electric. So my parents bought me, you know, the basics. They bought me the Strat Squire pack, you know, something to play with. And and it was fun. I loved it. I was still like jamming, trying to, I was already learning songs at that point from the artists that I liked. But I think the biggest thing for me was I used to see drummers growing up like in church playing, and I thought, okay, like I could think I can do that. And I started paying attention to that. I kind of dabbled, like started hitting around. I'd wait for everybody to leave and go up to the drum set and kind of figure it out, basically. And then the rest became history when one day someone in our church noticed, and she called our house. This was before like cell phones were really a thing. Asked for me, house phone. So like, hey, you know, phone's for you, Elijah. And, you know, I think my older brother handed me the phone, and she said, hey, can you play drums tonight at the church? And I said, like, I was confused. I was like, okay, like why? And I didn't think anybody was noticing. And she was like, yeah, you know, you're pretty good, I guess. And I was just like kind of in shock. I was taken back, but I was like, okay, I said yes. Yeah, like I said, the rest is history. I just started getting into it, started a band right out of, you know, junior high, like seventh or eighth grade into high school. And then in high school years, I took it the most serious, but I mean, I can look back at it now and start looking at like maybe footage or photos or things I was trying to write and be like, oh, that's awful. It's terrible. But yeah, that's where the real passion grew, I think. And so now here I am. I mean, that was over 10 years ago. So I've been playing like pretty much super passionately for about 15 years almost. And I've never looked back. And I think to this day, I'm still, you know, as we all should, just trying to learn more and trying to get better. And that that just comes with the territory. So yeah, that's kind of my journey. I think overall that kind of covers most of it.
Yeah. And then now you've just clicked over to 1,000 subs on YouTube, which is a pretty nice little milestone for yourself.
Thank you. And yeah,
to think of where you're at before and where you are now, and you're not just honing the craft. Other people know that you're honing the craft, and the visual spectacle you put on for the last few videos in particular, they've been awesome. They're a real performance, not just a drum cover in someone's house. Like, they're really something to look at, and I'll put something up here or there or something. Sure. But what studio are you at, or where are they getting done?
Backtrack only a hair. I started my channel over 10 years ago. Technically, I started my YouTube channel when there was like, literally, there was almost nobody. There was about four or five people doing drum covers. And I got lucky enough. I was in high school at the time where I was just like, let's do it, you know? And there was like, you know, now you look at YouTube and it's just like massive. Everybody's there. I mean, there's like 3-year-olds that are better than us, like just doing crazy
stuff.
We've
all done it. Yeah.
And so it's like at the time, though, it was so cool. And it was kind of nice to be a part of. But to kind of backtrack a little bit, try to make a long story short to answer that question. I had started the YouTube channel, and it was exactly like you said. It was in like my bedroom, like in my house. I had a little mixer and had some, and I, you know, worked hard and bought my first drum set myself, bought some drum mics and used my parents' camcorder and like made videos. And sad story was, there was this weird time within the first few years of YouTube where like a bunch of people lost their accounts. Like, they just got deleted out of nowhere. And so I had a fight to get my account back. But in getting it back, I lost like footage. All I got basically was my link, my URL, my name basically is all I got back. And subscriber counts, view counts, I had to re-upload my videos. So it sucked really bad. And since then, I've been hit and miss. Like, for the past 10 plus years, I've like had a year where I was like, put out 2 or 3 videos and it was awesome. Then I went another year or two, just super dry, didn't do anything. So a few years ago, while I was still living in California, which is where I grew up, you know, I lived there for over 25 years. I had a buddy the past couple of years who I had met through my scene, through just playing shows. And he actually had come up to me, and it's like, hey, I have a studio, blah, blah, blah. And I kept his card. I usually take it pretty seriously when other artists are trying to engage and, you know,
reach
do stuff.
Out. Yeah.
Yeah. And so it probably had been over a year. And then I decided to pull that card he gave me with his name and phone number and the studio name on it, and decided to hit him up and said, hey, I'm ready. Because I wanted to start taking it seriously again. So it's been about 3+ years. And I had started touring again as a drummer, because before that there was a whole stint of time where I wasn't even doing drums. I was a lead vocalist in a band and playing bass and doing other stuff. So when I decided to really get back into drumming, because, you know, I've been a drum teacher for over 10 years, it's like, I might as well play in a band. So I got back into it and hit him up. And that studio is in Sacramento. And so definitely a huge shout out to him and his studio. It's called the Sound Heart Collective. And he has an actual studio that was built, I think he said, in the 70s or 80s. And it's pretty badass. It's really awesome. It's an old school, real setup. It was built to be a studio, and he kind of took it over. And he's actually been renovating it. I've been watching his Instagram stories, and he's like adding some new rooms and redoing some of the walls and stuff. And it's a legit place. So I support him.
That's awesome.
He's a homie, but I pay him. I pay all my friends. Like, you know, anytime I did any of those videos, the ones that I've come out with in the past 2-3 years, they've all been with mostly the same crew of people. My friend Connor, his studio, my buddy Tyler his stuff is out there. Like, you could look him up too. He helps co-run, I believe, or maybe with a few other people, Caliber TV. It's a huge, live performance, recording. Like, they basically do the live videos for like big bands on like everything, like Warped Tour when it was a thing, all this kind of stuff.
Oh wow. That's
and yeah, so like big. Anybody watching this maybe like already knows who they are. I wouldn't be surprised if they looked up a live video and they did it, because it's like professional video and audio that they, you know, sync up and stuff and get the live audio. And so Tyler Dugani is his name. He has that, and then his own little side project thing, which he kind of started around the time he and I started working together. So he does the visuals, and then I usually have one or two other friends, just the old bandmates or just friends from like school. I went to school for recording and recording arts and stuff and producing. Have another friend, Connor, and he's helped out. Just I'll pay him a little bit of money, or, you know, buy him dinner and stuff for the day, and he'll do like lighting cues and help out with anything that needs to get done. So the visions for all those videos, I just come up with them. Like, I'll think of a song that I want to cover. Usually we'll pay like, you know, homage to like the band that I'm covering, like maybe their actual music video. I'll take the visuals from that, or the color scheme from that, or maybe just a vibe that it gives me, and then turn it into the actual visuals that you see when I do the drum covers. And then, yeah, we all just come together, and it literally every video takes a whole day. We go in and we'll set up like 9 or 10 in the morning. Set up the mic, set up the drums, and then set up the background, whatever it needs, you know, lighting, fog machines, whatever other props we need, costumes I'll have bought beforehand if I use them, depending on the video. We just kind of all just are doing our craft together, and it's a whole group thing. And I love doing it. Yeah, I love doing it. I miss it. I'm thinking of maybe doing one when I go visit again later next month, but we'll see what happens. So.
Well, that's exciting. So, what other projects are on the keel? Like, you got the band back on the other side, and that's still kicking along when it can. But like, what sort of projects are you working on at the moment?
Yeah, it's definitely an interesting season of my life right now, because, like I said, I moved, and that in itself, moving like over halfway across our country is like a big deal. And it's something I've never done, like dropping kind of everything to do. Right now is a really interesting time, because I'm full-time at Guitar Center. I actually run the lessons there. I'm the lessons manager. And the lessons department, you know, you've basically got a whole department geared towards like teaching music to, you know, and we try to cover as much as we can. We'll teach everything from obviously the regular, you know, guitars, drums, bass, piano, singing, to lately we're talking about trying to get some people on board teaching like DJing and recording arts and things like that. So we try to cover our ground. And like I said, this area, the Metroplex area in the Dallas area, is huge. So you've got a lot of people interested in a lot of different things, but it's taking a lot of my time. And so I've already expressed that I'm wanting to go back to part-time and teaching so that I can focus more on being in the studio. And when I say in the studio, I'm renting a studio spot here in Dallas, and I'm planning on doing YouTube a lot more frequently, like we talked about. It's like I've always wanted to do that, but I haven't been able to, you know, with time and you know, being in a different career and just money, finances, like getting it all lined up so that I can do that. And so hopefully in the next month, when I come back from a couple shows that I have with my band, I'm flying out to a few places to play some gigs. Starting in August, I'll be transitioning out of the managerial role, the lead role that I'm in, and getting back to teaching. So I'll be teaching just primarily drums. And then when I'm not teaching, I basically will be in the studio getting content out. And so it'll be a little hard on my own, but I have ways to do it. Like, I'm setting up as legitimate of a little setup as I can. Still have the vision to do the crazy, you know, lighting and effects, whatever I can do. At the end of the day, it's kind of everything music right now and everything drumming, which I love. And then just having that studio set up, I definitely plan to be recording some stuff that I've been writing. You know, I write my own stuff, and other bands I've been in, I wrote a lot of stuff. So just getting back, you know, getting the wheels rolling and getting everything going. It's a little bit of everything. It's a little bit of still gigging when I can here and there, which is fun because I can just get on a plane and go somewhere and do that. And then like in the morning, I'm getting up at 5 a.m. and I'm, you know, gonna do, we have record store day. I think you probably have that there, I'm assuming. Yeah. So the record store is across the street from my studio. And I was just telling my buddy right now, we're planning on getting up early, getting there an hour early, but there's already people lined up in front of our record store right now. It's like 8:30 in the evening here, and they're already lined up, which is crazy. But I mean, I get it. You know, I've been doing record store day for a long time, and it's just like, I don't plan on going that crazy, but I'm going to go there, get my records. The store opens at 7 a.m. and hopefully be out of there around 8:30, which shouldn't hopefully take that long. And then I'm catching a flight and I'm going to Wisconsin, which is in like the northern region of our country, and playing a show, and then I'm flying back the next morning. So there's a lot of back to back. It's been crazy, you know.
That's awesome. Worked
all day, like dealing with lesson stuff. Really, my life is for the first time ever fully revolving around music, which I don't think it's ever been fully music. So there's a lot. Really, there's basically a lot going on, and I'm just trying to balance it all out and figure it out.
Exactly. That's the dream, but also that's the key. The balance is the key. And I suppose when like that's where you want to be. That's where everyone wants to be. Like when it really, if you've got a craft, you got to balance that capital and time, because what's the point of having all the money to be able to support yourself if you never get a chance to play? Right. And if you say, all I'm going to do is just do this 100%, well, I have no money, so I'm going to hemorrhage money until I'm a millionaire playing music, which is unlikely. You need to get that balance, and then for the opportunities to come up and go, hey, fly up here. And like, I remember doing that with Carlu, and we flew up to Mackay to play with the Rubens, and it was just like a last minute thing. And suddenly it all just sort of threw together, and, you know, rearranging work and things, and getting a community of people, whether that be your work or just your friends or other people in different states that can help you out when you get there and all that, to build your community. So you've got a little home base wherever you go. And then it takes that pressure off, and you can sort of enjoy the balance more rather than going, man, I'm struggling for time. This is going to be really tight. And then you lose the enjoyment. As long as you can keep the enjoyment whilst you're trying to balance the act, then that's the dream.
Totally. I agree. It's, like I said, it's a transition time for me. It's been a few months of literally, this is my first time in an apartment. I've always had a house. I've gotten all the mics that I need set up for, you know, 'cause I'll be doing drum stuff to start off with, get my feet wet, do some more YouTube stuff, do some drum tracking for a couple projects, couple bands that, I've talked to about, you know, writing for them and stuff like that. But yeah, it's finding that balance, dude. And that's kind of where I'm at right now, is like just figuring it out. I think if you talk to me 3 months from now, it might be a little bit smoother sailing, and like, yeah, on like Mondays I do this or that. But right now it's just
routine's
like,
routine is key.
Yeah. So right now it's finding that, like, I'm literally in the middle of like, oh my gosh, I'm working 40 plus hours, like working at my store, you know, which is all music and it's great and it's fun, but it's still work. And then go from there to try and find a time to get to the studio and actually practice and record something. So, and then like, you know, oh, like tomorrow I'm literally flying out of state to go like play. And then, you know, in 2 weeks I go back to California for a week and I'm playing a festival. Like, I'm filling in for a band one night, then the next night playing for my band. And yeah, so it's like finding the balance of, you know, work, play, whatever. It's all, to me, it's all the same now. Music should be fun, but like, it's still work, you know? So I got to find that balance.
Yeah. Yeah, get that balance and also get that blend. When it does sort of all blend into one in the good way, and it's like, oh, it's pleasure, but like I'm getting paid for this, so I suppose by rights it is still work. That's good. Not when everything is so much that it all feels like work.
Yeah.
You know, you get that enjoyment factor in there. So, best gig you've ever played?
I come from a very DIY, like, do-it-yourself, you know, scene. So, eventually it's like you're forced to play in a house, you know, play a house show, play in someone's garage, things like that. So for me, memorable, like notable, it's like the most memorable for me might be to this day a show with my old band back in, I want to say 2012, 2011. It's been about 10 years, close to. And we had just gotten signed and we were a metal band, the band I was in at the time. And we wanted to shoot a music video. So we told everyone, hey, come to, and like, I don't even know what it was. It was some like building that was being built into something. We're like, hey, come to this building. This is the address. It's free. I think we provided pizza. I don't remember, but like people came in and feel it to this day. It's on YouTube. It's kind of like our little DIY music video, but that show I'll always remember because I was a lot more broke than I am now, but I was broke. I was like 18, and I couldn't afford much, but anything I could, I put it towards touring and my drum set and the band. And I broke every stick I owned. I broke probably a cymbal or two. I broke the batter side of my kick drum head. Like it was just a wild show. Like everyone was going nuts and it was fun, you know, and it got caught on camera. It's a video, so it's like I'll watch that sometimes to this day and even just like think about all the people, all the friends, stuff like that. That to me is the most memorable thing. But like, I mean, I've played some shows where it's like, whoa, this is crazy. I can't believe I'm playing this, or I can't believe I'm playing to this many people, or like I can't believe I'm playing this festival or this thing that like I always wanted to play, you know. So I have some of those, but everything always reverts back to me, what's memorable is like being there with all those people I knew, and like they were there for us when we were like not a big deal. And then when we got signed and kind of became a big deal, I guess you could say at that moment, they were all there, and it was just like the funnest thing. And like breaking all that stuff and just like having that crazy of a time to me is like, I'll cherish that over like getting paid the most for a gig, you know, or something like that.
I can totally relate to that. That sort of thing of the sentimentality, I suppose, of having a show that has all the people and all, you know, all the friendly face in the front row, and you tried so hard to get there, you know, or you could play to 1,000 people you didn't know, and you somehow managed to get the slot and it was cool, but no one spoke to you afterwards and you sort of just ducked in, ducked out, and you played 15 minutes. You know, there's something different about it. Each thing has its perks, and you know, it'd be nice to play a gig and earn a grand, but at the same time, there's something about playing to a bunch of your mates and everyone getting around you, and you know, you're the heroes of the night. Like, there's something about that for sure.
Right.
So I totally get what you mean. Where can all the people find you so that we can so that everyone can stay in touch with what you're up to? The tube and on the gram, hit me up. What are your plugs?
My stuff's pretty easy to find. If you look up on Instagram, on everything, it's Elijah. So that's pretty easy. Elijah with 3 R's. And the funny story behind that is I took that from back in the day. Like I said, there was only a few drummers on YouTube, like way back in the day. And there is a guy that people might know. I don't know if they remember, but his name was Chaser. He's also from California. And he was the only other guy doing like metal drum covers. Like, and he was starting to get big. And I was like, couldn't think of a name. So I took his idea of like having like the 3 R's at the end, and I just added it to the end of my name. So that's where it comes from. It's pretty easy to remember. And to this day, I've had that name for so long that I have like family and friends like call me that as a nickname. They'll call me Elijah.
I love that. Well, thanks for having a chat with me today. I know, as you mentioned, very busy man. I feel very privileged to have been able to fit into your exciting musical schedule. But I was looking forward to this, and no, you didn't disappoint with all your musical antics and all the exciting things you got going on. It's exciting to see what's coming up.
Yeah, man, no problem. I appreciate you asking me, and I always love talking with you. So we'll talk again soon for sure.
Absolutely. I'm looking forward to it. Well, guys, that's another rep in the bag, and it was awesome to have a chat with Elijah over in the US of A. So once again, YouTube's the only place you're going to find these. Every Tuesday, a new episode's coming out. So hit the bell, subscribe, do all the business so you don't miss out on an episode. And until next week, I'll see you later.